All right, so actually let me start off you guys with just a warm-up question. Warm-up exercise. You have a non-empty subset in R, and is bounded above, P is bounded above. This is actually something in your book, but I haven't mentioned it. We're gonna need it today. Show that this premium must be in closure.
I guess I can hand back some homework while you are thinking about that.
Yeah.
Must be
bounded. Okay, turn to somebody nearby and talk with them about this problem.
I was in the same position.
Join with one side or the other. Who would like to talk about it? And choose somebody at random? Jin, how about you? Jin, would you like to say something? Did you think about this problem?
Because it's a supremum, you can find, or you know that the supremum is going to be larger than any element.
Sure. Right. So supremum B is bigger than it's the least upper bound for any X and E. Yeah.
So then you pick a point, or you pick a distance that's smaller than that distance. bigger than the distance that's between any element and x, or any element and the supremum.
So, how do you know that there? You're saying that there's some distance. What is this distance?
I'm not sure.
Okay. I mean, so right, you've got your set E, right? You've got this point here. Supremum, you know that everybody in E is below it. That's true, right? And we're trying to show, think about what we're trying to show. We're trying to show that, you know, E is in the closure. In other words, E is either, I'm sorry, that the supremum is either in E or it is a limit point of E, right? Amia, you look like you want to step in.
I could be totally wrong about this, yeah. But so
right.
If the
That's
supremum
great.
Is greater than everything in E,
certainly it
then
is, yeah.
We know the distance between the supremum and any x is greater than zero. Can I say that? Or no?
Say that again. That
the distance between the supremum.
The
and
distance
E.
between the supremum and.
An x.
An x.
For any x, it's going to be greater than zero.
It's greater than zero.
And then, on the other hand.
Unless the supremum is in E itself, right? So you could have, right, so one possibility is that the supremum is in E.
Okay.
To start off with. But
if
that's true, then you're done, right? So
yeah.
If supremum is in E, then done. So you can, suppose the supremum is not in E.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, suppose the supremum is not in E. In that case, you know that, it is not in E.
And the option is, yeah.
Then it must
be
a limit point,
mm-hmm.
Right?
But, so then to establish that it's a limit point.
And you want to show that it's a limit point, okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. So, we want to show the supremum.
And then if you take another point that's also another bound of E that's not the least upper bound, so yeah, something bigger.
Okay.
Then the distance between M and X is going to be larger than.
I don't know where you're going, which could mean that you're going off base, so what are we trying to show? We're trying to show that this guy is a limit point.
Yeah.
In other words, that in every punctured, so this guy is not in here. So we want to show that in every neighborhood of this guy, there must be somebody from E. Right, there must be, so we want to show it's a limit point, in other words, i.e. we want to show that for any epsilon greater than zero, this neighborhood of the supremum has to intersect E, right? Okay, and you see why I got rid of the I don't need to put the star on it because supremum's not in there to begin with. Okay, so why is it clear that there has to be somebody from E in? I take a little radius here of epsilon, supremum plus epsilon, supremum minus epsilon. Why does there have to be somebody from E in there? Jonah?
Or else it wouldn't be a supremum.
Or else it wouldn't be the supremum, right? Because then you could find something smaller that would be an upper bound. That's the end. Great. So, so if not, if it is zero, if the intersection is empty, then supremum minus epsilon is an upper bound. Upper bound of E. That's a contradiction because supremum is the least upper bound. Okay. Yeah, Reed. I mean, Alex.
I was just wondering if these are going to be like similar to test problems.
This would not be a bad test problem.
Okay.
Except that it's you've seen it already.
God. But yeah, I mean, this would be comparable.
Yeah. In terms of difficulty, I think this would be pretty reasonable.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Everybody all right? Any questions? Okay. So now let's get to back to the main line of our story here. So remember, we're talking about compact sets. And the last thing we did was show that all K cells are compact, right? And we did this by the dyadic chopping up way, right? If it's not compact, that means that you can find an open cover for which there is no finite subcover, but then you can find this sequence of nested K cells, each of which cannot be covered by a finite number, each of which cannot be covered by a finite subcover, right? Then you use the finite intersection property, right, of the K cells. You take that point, and blah 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 blah. Okay, right. I hope you remember how that works, right? You know that point is going to lie inside of one of the open sets, and it's going to lie inside of a ball inside of one of those open sets, right? But you know that the size of the K cells is shrinking down to zero, so just take one that is so tiny that it lies inside that ball. That's a contradiction, right? Because then that square, you know, which supposedly was not covered by any finite subcollection, is covered by a single set. Right, from your original cover, so contradiction. Okay, so that's where we stopped, and that is the one of the steps in the famous theorem of Heine-Borel. Okay, actually, this is yeah. Okay. So here it is. Let's say that. So in Rn, the following are equivalent. A, B is closed and bounded. B, B is compact. C, E is what's called limit point compact. Limit point compact. In other words, every infinite subset of E has a limit point. We showed earlier that if you are compact, then you're limit point compact, right? Remember that? We showed that if you have a compact set, then if you have an infinite subset of that compact set, then it must have a limit point. So what we showed earlier was compactness implies limit point compactness, okay? And what we're going to see here is that all these things are equivalent. Okay. So, okay. So in my notes, I have A basically done. Right? If you are closed and bounded, then you're going to be compact. Okay. So can anyone explain that to me? My notes say it's basically done already. it's done, basically done already because of this, the previous thing, the previous result. Suppose you have a closed and bounded set. Then, since it's bounded, you can put it inside of a K cell, right? Well, we know that K cells are compact. The end. Right? Because it's closed. It's a closed subset of a compact set. Earlier we showed that any closed subset of a compact set is itself compact. Right? So, E bounded implies that E is contained in some K cell. Right? But then, E is a closed subset of a compact set. And so it's compact. B, showing that compact implies limit point compact, we actually did do already, so that's already done. And C, so we want to show that if you're compact, then you're limit point compact. So say that this should be A implies B. A implies B is done, B implies C is done, and now we're showing that C implies A. Sorry, as I mentioned before class, I didn't really sleep last night. Okay, so, A implies B, B implies C, now we're doing C implies A. Okay, so say that, suppose, E is limit point compact. And we want to show that E is close and bounded. Okay, we'll do this in two parts. Suppose E is not bounded. Suppose E is not bounded, then we're not going to be limit point compact. Then we can create a sequence that doesn't have any limit inside of E. Right? If it's not bounded, what does that mean? It means that suppose I pick a point, suppose I look at the origin. Okay. If it's not bounded, then for every ball of radius n, say, so I'm going to call this thing b sub n. Okay, every ball of radius n. E not being bounded means that there's some point outside of this ball. Right? Right? Thank you. Thank you for nodding. Then for each natural number, right, there exists some E sub n, some point in E, such that E sub n is not contained in the ball of radius n about 0. Right. Well, that sequence doesn't have a limit inside of E. It doesn't have a limit. It goes off to infinity. This E sub n, set of points E sub n, has no limit point. Is it clear that it has no limit point? So I just spoke in a kind of garbled way. I was talking about limits, but we were like talking about limit points. This sequence has, I'm sorry, this the set of points has no limit point, right? Why doesn't it have a limit point? Well, to have a limit point, you'd have to have this point where there's an infinite number, where in every neighborhood there's an infinite number of points, right? But that doesn't happen. Right? Here's one of the east of n's, and I take a neighborhood around it, a radius epsilon. For this guy to be a limit point, there must be infinitely many of the e sub n's inside here, right? But that's impossible because this ball, you know, this ball of radius m, right? This ball of radius m contains only finitely many of the e sub n's.
Why is that? That only contains a finite.
Is it because there's countable in? You're taking a finite subset of countable numbers, so that's finite?
So think about how we constructed this. So think about how we constructed them, right? We constructed it so that e sub n lies outside the e sub n are at least distance n from the origin, right? Okay, so now I have this radius m. Okay, how many of the e sub n are in here? Well, at most there are m of them, right? Because if I look at e sub m plus 1, it lies outside this ball, right? So how many, if I look at e sub m plus 2 and so on and so forth, they all lie outside this ball, right? So how many guys are inside this big ball? Well, at most m. Shall we do it again? We'll do it again. Okay, so here's how we start off with the origin here, and we say, okay, look, for every natural number n, there's going to be some e sub n that's outside. Okay, so the e sub n's are outside the ball of radius n. Okay, this thing has no limit point. Why? Suppose you have a limit point. Okay, let's call this guy P. Suppose there is a limit point P. Okay, take a radius. A radius of 1 around the P. Okay. Now take some ball where the radius is some integer, right? The integer, call that integer n. Okay, so that this integer n is bigger than the distance from 0 to p plus 1. Okay, now how many of the e's could lie inside here? Well, at most n, right? Because once we get to e sub n plus 1, that guy lies outside this n ball, and everybody past it also lies outside. So there's at most n points in here, so this could not be a limit point, right? Being a limit point means you have to have infinitely many guys inside here. Think about it. It's okay. I see you're not getting, but that's okay. Not getting things immediately doesn't matter. Just go home and think about it. I'd say like 90% of the time I did not understand what was happening, and then I went home and thought about it. Yeah, I barely understand what other people say to me now. Okay. So if it's not bounded, then we see that E is not limit point compact. So it has to be bounded, right? Second thing, suppose V is not closed. If E is not closed, well, that means it doesn't contain a limit point, right? So then there exists some point x naught in the complement such that x naught is a limit point of E, right? Not being closed means you're missing a limit point. You're missing at least one of your limit points. Call that guy x naught. Okay. But then again, for all natural numbers, there's going to be, right, u being a limit point means that in every neighborhood there exists a guy e sub n that lies in the 1 over n neighborhood of u and is in E. There's somebody who's in E and is within 1 over n of x naught. So if you look at the radius 1, there's some E1 in there. You look at the radius 2, there's some E2 in there. Look at the radius 3, 1 over 3, sorry, 1, 1 half, 1 third, and so on and forth. Right? So you get these guys that all lie in here, right? But then the trouble is, so then that is a sequence. That is an infinite set. That is an infinite subset of E, but converges to something, to a point not in E. Right? And that's trouble because we're supposed to be limit point compact, right? Every infinite subset should converge to somebody who is inside E, but we've converged to somebody who's not inside E. Right? I mean, every infinite subset should have a limit point that is in E, but here we've got this guy and it has a limit point and it's not in E. Okay. So you might say at this point, how do you know that, maybe there's some other point could be the limit point, right? Why can't there be some other point in there such that, well, which is a limit point? A limit point of this infinite set here. But that's impossible because consider the following set of inequalities. If you look at the distance of E n to Y, that's bigger than or equal to the distance of x naught to y minus the distance of x naught to e to n by the triangle inequality. Now, this distance here. This distance here is smaller than 1 over n, so this difference is going to be bigger than this minus 1 over n. Right? Because this thing is smaller than 1 over n. So if you subtract something bigger, then it gets smaller. Right? Okay. Now choose for n big enough, and bigger than some, for n big enough, say. For n big enough, this is going to be bigger than this minus a half the distance of x naught to y. which is 1/2 the distance of x onto y. Okay, so what does this tell you? This tells you that you can't have infinitely many points close to y, right? For n big enough, all these guys are outside of some fixed distance, right? Like here's this other point, and you're saying, oh, maybe this is your limit point. Maybe this is your limit point. But if you look at this, you see that that there is some fixed distance, right? So let's call this distance delta. Right? There's some positive distance delta, and past a certain point, everybody lies outside of delta. So there's only finitely many guys inside the delta neighborhood of y. So y could not be a limit point. Right? To be a limit point, again, you'd have to have infinitely many guys inside this neighborhood. Y cannot be a of the reason. Wait, you're looking. Your brow is furrowed.
Yeah. It's the same thing that Y didn't get the earlier part of the proof.
Okay.
Y,
yeah.
In like a circle.
Yeah.
With infinite points, Y could only finite. Why there are only finitely many points, or either that ends.
This is exactly it.
Yeah.
So the E sub n are getting arbitrarily close to the x naught. Right, the distance from E sub n to x naught is smaller than 1 over n. Okay. So, you know, just past a certain point, that 1 over n is going to be smaller than half the distance of x naught to y. Right? So there's only finitely many guys. So past a certain point, all the E sub n's lie outside of some delta ball, right? But that means that for any delta ball, there's only finitely many guys who could lie inside of it, right? Because past a certain point, they are outside of it. Okay, great. Mia, you're looking somehow kind of disgusted.
Oh, no, sorry, I'm not disgusted.
Okay, good.
Is there like a visual way to represent, like, to show that? Not with.
Yes.
I still don't
yes.
See how
yes.
Like.
Let's. Okay. Let me make it. Let me make it more visual. So here is. Here is the point that we said was the limit point.
Okay.
And then here are the E sub n. They are getting close. They are getting close to this guy, right? And you know, the distance from these guys to the distance from the E sub n to the x naught is smaller than 1 over n. Now suppose that there's some other guy over here, y, and you're saying, I think that there might be that this infinite set might have some other limit point, right? We need another to be limit point compact. You know, we need to show that there's some limit point in E. I think this guy is it. Okay, I think this guy is it. Okay, but then you look at the distance of E sub n to y. Okay, so let's look at these distances. Please look at the lengths of these distances. And what you see is that past a certain point, all of them are more than half the distance, more than half the distance between x naught and y away from y. Right?
All of the E sub n.
All the E sub n's eventually are inside this ball. Right? So that tells me that inside this ball around y, there's only finitely many of the E sub n's. So y could not be a limit point, because to be a limit point, you have to have infinitely many guys in every neighborhood. Yeah, Mia.
I guess what's confusing me is when I'm thinking about the guys inside the neighborhood.
Yeah.
We're like, when did E sub n being the only points there? Like, sorry, what do we?
you have to remember what we're trying to do.
Yes.
Right? We created an infinite subset.
Yes.
And we saw that it converged to a point outside of the set.
Yeah.
Okay. So, I'm sorry, we created an infinite subset. We saw that this infinite subset had a limit point outside the set. What we're trying to show is that there could not be a limit point inside the set also for this infinite subset. Mm-hmm. So we're sticking with this one particular infinite subset that we created. Okay? Because to be limit point compact means that any infinite subset will have a limit point inside that set. Mm-hmm. Right? Well, we've created an infinite subset that has a limit point outside the set and has no limit points inside the set. Mm-hmm. Okay, so there's two parts to it. We show that it has a limit point outside, and we're also showing that there's no limit point inside. Okay, let's go on, otherwise we'll never get anywhere. Okay, go home and think about it. That's all right. Being confused is part of the game. I told you about Welcome to Mathematics, right? Yeah? The story of Welcome to Mathematics? Okay. So, when I was a third year graduate student, I was kind of depressed about how little I understood. And I went to talk with my advisor. He's like one of these, you know, super genius type guys. He's like from a family of geniuses. His older brother won the Fields Medal, you know. Right. I think he got his PhD when he was 24 or something, which was 5 years later than his older brother had gotten his PhD. Right, yeah. You know, this sort of family. Anyway, so I went to talk with my advisor. I said, "Oh, you know, professor, you know, I feel stupid all the time." And he said, "Welcome to mathematics." And he like smiled and it's like, "Welcome to mathematics." And that sort of cheered me up a little, right? Because and he said, and basically that's how you're gonna feel 99% of the time, right? 99% of the time you're gonna feel stupid. So, you know, if somebody like this feels stupid 99% of the time, that's okay. Then I feel a little bit better about myself, right? Okay. So let's go on. Let's talk about connected sets. I don't like connected sets, but they're in the book. And so there's a little bit in the text about connected sets. Let's define them at least. I was hoping to get onto continuity today. I don't want to talk too much about this stuff. It's not going to be that crucial. Okay. So here's the definition. You have a metric space, and you have two sets A and B inside the metric space. There's two parts to this definition. First, if A intersect B closure is empty, and A closure intersect B is empty, then we say A and B are separated. A and B are separated. Okay. So, right. So, for example, if we are in R, and we look at something like this, right? These two open intervals, A and B, right? Then these guys are separated, right? Because the closure of A does not intersect B. The closure of B does not intersect A. So that would be separated. Something like this would not be separated, right? If we closed closed the other, if we made A B closed on the inside, right? Then that would not be separated because then A would intersect B closure, right? We close B, we get the closed set that would intersect A. So these guys are not separated. Right? These guys separated. Guys are not separated. Okay. part two. If E can be expressed as A union B, where A and B are separated, then we say that E is disconnected. E is disconnected, right? So they can be expressed as a union of separated sets, right? It can be expressed as a union of separated sets, then it's called disconnected, right? If not, if it cannot, so otherwise, we say E is connected, right? So being connected means that you cannot be expressed as, right, cannot be expressed as a union of separated sets. Cannot be expressed.
Okay.
So let's quickly get through this. So proof, theorem. A subset of R1 is connected if and only if, for all x and y in the set, the open interval x comma y is contained in the set. Okay, so what does it mean to be connected? What does it mean to be connected in R1? It means that you have this property that, given any two points in your set, the open interval is contained. Okay. So let's do the proof. So we'll show that not B implies not A. Suppose that you have some x and y in E, but there's some point Z, such that Z is between x and y, and Z is not in E. Okay. Then we'll show that it's not connected. Okay, so to show the forwards direction. Okay, so the point is this, it's easy to say, well, look, then let A sub Z be E intersect the interval negative infinity Z, let B sub Z be E intersect the interval Z comma infinity. Then E equals AZ union BZ, and which are separated sets. A union of separated sets. So E would be disconnected. So if this is not true, then this is not true. In other words, this implies that. Proved by contraposition. Everyone all right? Okay. Nora, is it all right? Do you get this or?
Yes.
You're just copying it off. Okay. Right. Okay. Let's do the reverse direction. Suppose that say E is not connected. Right? So So as E is disconnected, then E is, actually let me, I'm going to need some more space, so let me do this here. Separated sets, right, where A and B are separated, right? A intersect B closure is empty, A closure intersect B is empty. Okay, now, we do something funny. We say, well, consider the supremum of A intersect, sorry, back up. Pick X and Y in E, and say, suppose that X is smaller than Y. Then consider the set, consider the point, the supremum of A intersect, X comma Y, and call that thing Z. Right, it's bounded, so we have a supremum. Now we know that Z is contained in the closure of A. Right, we just saw earlier that if you're the supremum, you're contained in the closure of the set. The closure of this thing is contained inside the closure of A, right? So Z is contained in the closure of A. But being in the closure of A means that we're not in B. So Z is not in B. And we also know that Z is between X and Y, and it can't be Y. I messed up. X is in A, and Y was in B. Is the supremum of this thing, right? It's going to lie between X and Y. It can't be Y because Y is in B and Z was not in B, right? Z is in A bar. Z is in A bar, so Z is not in B, so it's not Y. Okay, so now if Z is not in A, then that would give us Z could not be X either, right? Because X was in A, right? And we would have Z is not in A, and Z is not in B, right? But that would be a contradiction because, right? Supposedly, for every pair of points, the whole open interval lies in E. Right. Not in E. And
so why can Z not equal X? Or
if Z is not in A.
Oh, okay.
If Z is not in A, then Z can be X, and we'd be done.
Okay.
So then we got another case to
do.
Okay, so now if Z is actually in A, then we can't use Z, but we'll do something. We'll get another point that will do it for us.
Okay.
If z is in A, then z is not in the closure, right? Because they're separated sets, right? And so, being not in the closure, we know that there exists some z1 such that z1 is between z and y, and z1 is not in B. This guy is not a limit point of B, right? He's not a limit point of B, so there's an interval around him that's not contained in B, right? Well, choose somebody in that interval on the right-hand side, right? Then that guy is not going to be in B, and it's between Z and Y. Okay. But then, so that Z1 is not in B, but then what we have is that then right. Then z1 lies between x and y, right? Because z was bigger than x or bigger than equal to x. Then z1 lies between x and y. And remember what z was. Z was the supremum of the guys in A, right? The supremum of the guys between x, y that lie in A. So we know that z1 is not in A either, right? So and z1 is not in A because of construction of z, right? But that means that we have this guy that's not in E and yet lies between X and Y. Okay. So if we're disconnected, then the second thing fails. In other words, you know, B implies A by contraposition. I find this sort of argument really boring. So if you all are bored, that's good. And I should cheer you up by saying that, you know, most of the results that we'll be dealing with don't have to deal with connected sets. So don't really get it, but if you don't like it, that's all right. Are there any questions about the argument? Any questions about the argument? No? Okay, let's go on then. Okay. Okay. So way back when I first took this course, we used Rudin's book, and we skipped chapter 3, and then we came back to it later. And I think that's actually a pretty reasonable thing to do, because chapter 4 is really where you get to see the application of compactness. It's all about, you know, how you use compactness. And so I think it's reasonable to go from chapter 2 to chapter 4, and then maybe 5. We'll get back to chapter 3 eventually. But right now let's go to chapter four, where we get to see. So chapter 4 is about continuity. And really about how compactness interacts with continuity, right? Like in the case of the extreme value theorem, right? That's one of the things that we hope to get. Okay, but in order to talk about continuity, we have to talk about the notion of limit. So these are all things that you've probably encountered before, but again, we're going to see them in a rather different way, in a way that can be extended to other settings. So we'll talk about continuity in terms of limits. Limits will be defined in terms of neighborhoods. Okay. And anyway, so you'll think that it's maybe not at all what you remember. Okay. So what does to talk about continuity, we need to talk about limits, right? The limit of a function. Can somebody tell me what does it mean? Say, suppose that we're in good old Rn. I'm saying good old R, and somebody says the limit of your function is L as x approaches c. What does that mean to you? It means nothing to you. F of c equals L. That's actually not true, right? You could have something like this, right? There's a hole there. Right? It actually doesn't say anything about what happens at c itself. It doesn't say anything about what happens at c itself. Just to give you a humorous aside, this was kind of graph bathroom graffiti at the University of Chicago. The limit of fun of x as x approaches the University of Chicago is zero. Right? The University of Chicago, you know, the unofficial slogan, where fun comes to die, was when I was there as a graduate student, you know, there was this poll put out, you know, 300 schools, what are the top 300 party schools, and what are the best party schools? 300 schools on the list. University of Chicago, number 300. And they were very proud of that. Because they believe, rightfully, that their school was just for the mind, right? However, this bathroom graffiti reveals a certain level of ignorance, right? Because it's saying as you approach the University of Chicago, fun approaches zero, but it doesn't say what happens at the University of Chicago, right? At the University of Chicago, the fun could be 100 years. Right. So this graffiti is actually really okay. So what does the limit? What does this mean? Reed.
As you make at the input to the function arbitrarily close to a certain value, the function will approach.
So maybe this is how you think of limit, but as you see, this is not like a mathematical definition. Right? What does it mean to get arbitrarily close? What do we mean by arbitrarily close? So the real way of phrasing this actually has to do with neighborhoods, and wasn't really discovered until the 19th century by I think Weierstrass. So here's the definition. So you have two metric spaces, but if you want, just think of it. Suppose you've got R and R. So you've got two metric spaces. Okay, and you have a subset of X, and you have a point in E prime. In other words, you have a limit point of E, and you have a function. Function going from E into Y. Okay, so function from one metric space to another. Right? But again, you can think of this just as you've got something going from the reals to the reals. Like you've got the function f of x equals 2x. Okay, and you've got some point here p. Right, p is 5 or something like that. Right? We want to talk about the limit. What does it mean for the limit of f as x approaches p to be 10. Okay, so here is the sort of technical definition, if there exists a Q in Y such that for every epsilon greater than zero, so for every neighborhood of Q, such that for every neighborhood of Q, there exists a punctured neighborhood of P, such that F of that punctured neighborhood parts of it that lie within the domain of F lie in the epsilon neighborhood of Q, then we say the limit of F of X as X equals P is Q. Rewrite the whole thing without using the word neighborhood, but just using the word distance, okay? Because neighborhoods are about distance. So if there exists a Q in Y such that for all epsilon greater than zero, there exists a delta greater than zero, such that such that whenever X in E satisfies that the distance to P is less than delta and bigger than zero, whenever this happens, we have the distance of f of x to Q is less than epsilon. Then we say the limit of f of x is q as x approaches p. All of this is best thought in terms of some simple picture. Okay, so don't, you know, it's a lot of notation, but just think like this. Okay. Here's a function, and let's use a function that's not that complicated. Right? F of x is 2x, and let's say that we're looking at the point 3, and of course, you know, the limit of that, we know that the limit of that as x approaches 3 is going to be 6. Right. Okay. What does it mean for the limit to be 6? It means that there's this point Q, right? This is our Q. And this point has this property that for every neighborhood around Q, there's a punctured neighborhood around P that F maps inside there. Okay? Okay. So, for example, you know, if I say I'm going to take the neighborhood 6 plus 2, 6 minus 2, right? I take the neighborhood of radius 2 around 6, okay? Tell me a neighborhood around 3 that the function maps inside 4, 8. What neighborhood around 3 is such that all the points inside here get mapped inside that integral there? Well, could I take like 10, negative 4? No, right? That's not going to work. What neighborhood is it? Come on.
2, 4.
Thank you. 2, 4, right? 2, 4, right? There's somebody. I took a neighborhood over here, and I can find a neighborhood over here that gets mapped inside there. Okay. Now, suppose I take a neighborhood of radius 1, 6 plus 1, 6 minus 1, right? Can I find a neighborhood over here that gets mapped inside there? Sure. What is it?
Greater than 2.
Right? 2.5, 3.5? Right. So I take a radius of 1/2 here, right? And that neighborhood would get mapped inside of this one. Right, suppose I take something of a radius, a radius, 1/1,000,000,000, right? Can I find a neighborhood around 3 that gets mapped inside that neighborhood of 1/1,000,000,000th radius? Sure. What's the radius of what I'm looking for? 1/2,000,000,000th, right? 1/2 of 1,000,000,000th, right? Okay. So what does it mean for the limit to be 6? It means that if somebody wants you to stay within some arbitrary tiny distance of 6, then there's a neighborhood around 3 in which that is satisfied. That happens. Okay? Right? No matter how tight somebody requires you be to Q, there is a place around P where that happens. There's a punctured neighborhood around P where that happens. Okay, same thing over here, right? No matter what distance, right? No matter what distance the outputs are required to be within Q, there is a distance to P, so that if you're within that distance of P, but not at P itself, right? But not at P itself, then everybody, all of your outputs satisfy that distance, right? Satisfy that tolerance.
Can you be at Q itself, though?
Yeah. Yeah, so it's okay for your function to just be flat, right? That'd be great, in fact, right? Because then, no matter what epsilon you're given, you could take any delta, and you'd satisfy it, right? But we don't want to specify anything about what happens at P itself, and that's why we throw in this thing here. Right? We say, the points that are within delta of P, but not at P itself, their outputs, the output values would all be within epsilon of Q. Okay, so that is what we mean by limit. Okay, that's the actual definition of limit. Okay, right. Given any tolerance. Right, so in the metric space world, what we're saying is that here's our space X, here's our space Y, right, and here is P. P is a subset of P is in E. It's a limit point of E. And here is Q. Right, given any neighborhood of Q. Right, given any epsilon neighborhood of Q, there is a delta neighborhood of P, so that everybody in here gets mapped inside, the ball here gets mapped inside the ball there. Okay. So just to free ourselves from this picture, although we haven't freed ourselves that far. Okay. So I hope some of you have seen this before in calculus class. Anybody seen this in calculus class? Raise your hand if you saw in the calculus class. Okay. Okay. Let's just go on. So here's one fact. If F has a limit at P, then that limit is unique. In other words, you can't have two points Q. So here's P. You can't have two points Q that both act as the limit. Okay. Right. You can't have two points that are both the limit of f of x as x approaches p is q1 and it's also q2. Okay. We have 2 minutes. Does anyone know how to prove this offhand? suppose you have these two guys and they're both limits. That's going to lead to some sort of contradiction. How does that lead to a contradiction? They're both limits. In other words, given any epsilon neighborhood, you can find a neighborhood of P that gets mapped inside there, the epsilon neighborhood of Q1. And it's also true of Q2. Given any epsilon neighborhood of Q2, you can find a neighborhood of P that gets mapped inside that neighborhood of Q2. Adam?
And you deal with epsilons that are less than half the distance between.
Right, so you say, okay, suppose Q1 is not equal to Q2, and both are limits. Those are limits. And then take epsilon to be, say, smaller than half the distance between Q1 and Q2. Right? But then there exists a delta 1 such that F maps the delta 1 neighborhood around P inside of the epsilon neighborhood of Q1, and there's a delta 2 neighborhood such that this is contained inside the epsilon neighborhood of Q2. Right? So take some distance here that's smaller than half of the distance between these two guys, right? We know, because this guy is a limit, there's some neighborhood delta 1 here, like everybody inside here gets mapped inside here, right? There's another neighborhood, delta 2, say, everybody inside here gets mapped inside of here. But then anybody who lies in the intersection has to lie in both of them, right? Which is a contradiction, because the lying in both of them, well, they don't intersect each other. The intersection is empty, right? So then, F of the minimum lies inside the intersection. And that's empty. But P was supposed to be, remember, P was a limit point. Right? But P was a limit point of E prime. Right? So again, let's have this thing. P is inside of E, P is inside of X, et cetera, et cetera. Same notation before. But P was supposed to be a limit point, so you know there had better be elements of E. There's supposed to be there had better be guys of E who are, you know, in that neighborhood of P, right? So. So that's a contradiction, right? Because they have to be, there would be some image, but there is no image. Okay, so contradiction. Okay, that's it for today. Sorry to hold you a little bit over. Try to read up to something called uniform continuity. Okay, uniform continuity. Definitely try to read that before the next class, because that's a tricky concept. So what happens when you have a continuous function on a compact set? Yes, you get some sort of better, something better than just plain old continuity. You get something called uniform continuity.